man will manifest that and kill and die and give us the power to destroy the work of the devil in Jesus' name. And then today we're going to start from to demonstrate the power of God. To demonstrate the power of God in Jesus' name. When we talk about demonstrating the power of God, as we all know in the book of Acts, chapter 1, verse 8, the disciples, they were in wonder of God. They were waiting and praying for the Holy Spirit to come upon them. Jesus put them and said, when the Holy Spirit come upon you all, you will be able to do great and mighty things in Jesus' name. We cannot demonstrate the power of God without having an encounter with the Holy Spirit as a Christian, as a church, in Jesus' name. So in order for us to be able to demonstrate the power of God as a church, as believer, we first have to have a personal encounter with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit first have to be part of our life, have to be part of our daily activity. We have to have that personal relationship with the Holy Spirit. In having that personal relationship with the Holy Spirit, we are going to receive the power. And receiving the power, it will give us the ability to demonstrate the power of God in our life, in our ministry, in whatsoever we are being called to do in Jesus' name. In the book of Acts chapter 3, it talks about a man at the gate of Beautiful. He had been sitting there begging for alms and begging for alms from years to years. But when he met up with a disciple, he was begging for alms. But Peter said, "Say what and go, I have not. But what I have in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk." The power of God was demonstrated right there. And immediately the man took his belly and he began to walk. The disciple could not have done that with all the help of the Holy Spirit, with all the Holy Spirit being present in their life in Jesus' name. Amen. So we found out that demonstrating the power of God, we have to rely on the Spirit of God, on the Holy Spirit. We have to have the Spirit of God within us. That is the only way that we'll be able to demonstrate the power of God. We also can demonstrate the power of God through the Word of God. Because the Word of God is life. Bible says it's spirit and it's life. And once we have the faith and have the Spirit of God living within us, as we speak the Word, in whatsoever situation, the power of God can be demonstrated there. That situation can change. That situation can be active. We can see God moving in miracles, in different dimensions. God can be moving, touching the life of his people, showing things, revealing things to us through the power of the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. So in order for us to demonstrate the power of God, we need the Holy Spirit. We need the Holy Spirit. We need to rely and do everything through the Spirit of God. If we depend on ourselves, thinking that, oh, once I give my life to God, I'm saved, I can just do anything. But once we are saved, giving our life to God, we need to take another step by having a personal encounter with the Holy Spirit that will be able to demonstrate the power of God in Jesus' mighty name. Then, to show the love of God, that is one of the purpose of the church. After demonstrating the power of God, show the love of God. For Bible says, God is love. In Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like for us to look at 1 John chapter 3, 16 to 18. Verse 16 to 18. It says, "By this we know love, because he laid down his life for us, and we also example of to lay down our lives for the brethren. For whoever has this world, food, and see his brother in need, and shut up his heart from him, how does the love of God abide in him? My little children, let us not love in words or in tongue, but in deeds and in truth. And by this we know that we are of the truth and shall assure our hearts before him. In Jesus' name. He said, for the greatest love, Jesus came down and laid his life for us. That is the greatest love that God has shown us. By knowing no sin, came down and took our sin and laid his life down that we will be saved in Jesus' name. So it's saying that by this great demonstration that God has shown to us, we also have to lay down our lives for our brethren. Also have to lay down our lives for our brother. It does not mean that we're going on the cross to be killed or to be crucified. No, Jesus has already paid the greater price for us. But in situation that our brothers have or our sister have, and we know we are able to help one another, it's better that we're able to stretch up our hands and be able to assist that person. That's why it says that, my little children, let us not love in words or in tongue. Do not just say, oh, I love my brother, or I love my sister, or I love the person on your lips or in your tongue. And when you see that person in a situation that needs assistance, then you are unable to help that person. Even though you know that you can help, or you are unable, you find out that maybe you say that it's not your business, or you don't have energy to do it. No, we should be able to help that person. It says, love in words or in tongue, but in deeds and in truth. Which means in deeds, we should show action. We should be able to show action when it comes to love. We shouldn't just say, oh, I love this person, or I love that other person. But we should be able to show action. We should be able to render services if we can. Be able to help that person if we can. Be able to assist that person if we can. Because Jesus has shown us the greater love by him coming down to die for us, laying down his life that we will be saved from our sin. It's the greatest love. And if Jesus was able to do that for us, then what is so difficult that we'll not be able to do for our brothers and sisters? So we should take this greater love that God show us to be able to conquer everything that comes our way by saying that if God, Jesus, was able to do this for us, crucify himself, innocent person was able to crucify himself for us, then why I can't just forget about that thing or show love or just walk over that thing or just step over that thing and move forward in my Christian life in Jesus' mighty name.
Now, as a question, as we continue, that if we have dealt with this love during Bible study, and it's still, I'm sure that people still have issues. My question is this: how do we, as Christians, overcome the negative consequences that follow your actions of love? I don't know if that question is understanding. Mr. Mona, did you understand the question? Because you were not paying attention, that's why. I said, how do we overcome the negative consequences or the negative perception, negative reactions that sometimes follow the act of love? The Bible says, do not love in words, only in tongue, but in action and in deed. my experiences in life has really shown me that when people pretend to care, they show love. They kind of want you to think that they're showing love. They feel concerned about what they're going through. People tend to love that. People that are receiving that concern, and they tend to actually appreciate that more than if you go out of your way to love in action. I don't know, you know, you tend to pay a price for doing that. What you people tend to paint you in bad light for showing this love in action, not just in word. Yes, they tend to make you look stupid. As if, after all, did I ask you to do? Do that make sense?
Yeah.
Love is a command, and as such, when we do love, we're not actually loving the person, we are loving God. And if we believe that, the attitude or the response you get from those that you love, whether positive or negative, should not influence you. You focus on God. You do not love that person, you're loving God. It's a command.
Really? Yeah, it's a command, no. Okay, look at the situation. I met a brother yesterday. We were talking. Let me use this situation to give analysis. The nephew called from Nigeria while we were talking. The senior brother's son called. There was a lot of argument on the phone. And when he finished asking what's going on, he was so sad. He said, this young boy, his lady, very early to marry, around 26, 27, was suffering in another part in Nigeria. So he looked at the situation and felt that if he allowed this guy to stay there, even if he wanted to help him there, he might not break through easily because of so many issues. So he decided to bring the boy to Lagos, rented an apartment, paid for 2 years for him. And asked him, well, what kind of business you want? The guy mentioned the business he wants to do. So he wanted to settle the guy. They called it long story short. The apartment that he rented for this guy, after 3 months, the guy went back to the person that helped him to rent the apartment for him and said that he wants the money back. That the place is not a good place. He did not consult me when he rented this place. Otherwise, you know what? I'm going to just leave the key. You can move in and live there. He said, no, I'm going back to where I came from. I don't want anybody to waste my time. The guy got this and he was so, he said, what do you say? I'm wasting your time now? Now, you'll be calling there. Now you see, you sit back and ask yourself. This guy was suffering. And this guy did what most people would not do. To help this guy, he was already getting ready to set him up again in another business to have a means of livelihood. After paying this place for 2 years, and this guy will say, look, I don't want anybody to waste my time. I better go back to where I came from. Now tell me, how will you feel?
Let us go deeper than, let us go beyond the boy in question. He is not the one acting. The guy who brought him out of where he was and brought him to Lagos, the first thing he should have done is to find out the root of his problems. Probably the boy needs deliverance. What is speaking through him wants him to go back to that same place he came back. That's where he probably will meet his doom. Something is dragging him back.
I love you because
you're
very spiritual.
The issue here is, in the first place, I don't know whether the guy is a Christian or is not a Christian. Now, and secondly, the guy did not understand having to go back, it brings my mind to the children of Israel. When they were moved out of Israel, out of Egypt, they got to a point, they started looking back. Oh, if when it is taking cheese, we'll be eating what I will be eating it. You see, but at the point when they understood where God was bringing them out of the place, they started acting differently. So, you know, the Bible's talking about brethren, is talking about brethren in the house of God, not just any other person. But you see, in the family, you meet people like this. But the first thing you have to do is you are acting upon the word of God to bless your family member. Now, if the person like Brother Tony said, respond positively or not, you have done your best. That you don't have to do anything anymore.
All said and done, you know, we need to understand we are human beings. All what when we say we love, we do it, you know, we really cannot do anything. The experience I have come to know, because I've been born in that area so many times, come to know that you cannot really help the beggar. It's not everybody that God has you to help. Sometimes, like a relationship and all, that's what we need to know. Relationship at a human level has to be established and truly recognized. Otherwise, you can say it's my nephew. Does nephew really know you are uncle? So if he doesn't take you at high esteem, and you're trying to move from Mexico to Jerusalem, it will not work. There has to be that establishment. He know you are uncle. He know you mean good for him. But if this just say, oh, uncle, nephew, that's why it doesn't work. There have to be esteem for you to start up. That's why they help you move for some modern game big value.
Okay. If I understand Pastor's question very well, is that what will you do? You know, you are the one receiving the negative vibes, you know, coming to you, not the other person. So what do you do? I have experienced that so many times. And honestly, I feel bad. And it may even stop me helping somebody that is genuine, you know, because I feel that I am used. I feel that somebody has, you know, used me for granted. You know, as a human being, I'm not talking spiritual now, but as a human being, that is how I felt. I have helped so many people, and some of them, their reaction or something makes me wonder, why did I even go there? But if we want to really go into it, as humans, it hurts us. You have to pull a break on the next person that comes your way for help. And then you start thinking, do I really need to go there? But I think the only thing that can overcome that is just grace. You ask God. God, you know, you go to God and ask God before you help the next person. Because that next person can be the real, genuine person that needed the help. But because of your experience at the back, you don't help that person. But as a human being, it hurts you. And it may prevent you from helping the next person.
Amen.
Yeah, I'll just be
in Jesus' name. What I want to say,
you want to say something?
Okay. Yes. Well, like Pastor was saying, all his uncle done for him when he was suffering and he didn't appreciate it. Maybe in that case, he didn't need for your uncle to bring him to Lagos. He wanted to just give him the money and decide what he wanted to do with the money. He was not trying to relocate to Lagos. That's why he did what he did.
He actually did not understand. He didn't understand why. Because if the person really understands that he was suffering and that he needs to move, I don't think he would have loved to go back to the city, to the village or the rural area. But you see, as a, like the father, as a man, you know, he's going to hurt you for, you know, helping, but that should not stop you from reaching out to another person, because that is what God, when you talk about God's love in us, then the love of God in us, you know, when you see somebody suffering because of their love, you cannot turn away from it. That's why John was saying, so if we don't do it, where is the love of God in us? If the love of God in you, yes, if the love of God is in you, you see, you see in somebody you don't know, but because of the love in you, you have compassion upon the person, and you, like you are, you, this, the Bible says, when Jesus saw the people, he had what? Compassion for them, and this what? That compassion moved him. It is the compassion of God in us that moves us to do things for others, not in our human nature. We will not do it, but it is because of the, you know, divine love, let me put it, the divine love of God instilled in us as children of God, as children of salvation. That's why, you see, John talk about Christ dying for us. It's a sacrifice. The believer doing something for somebody is a sacrifice. It's something we are paying. Instead of we enjoying it, we are giving out. Hallelujah. And that is the way I see it. And so the man of God or the uncle, though he will feel pain, but he should take it as he is doing it unto God. Amen.
Amen. First of all, I want us to know that the life that we go through today is not everybody will appreciate what you do for them. That's the first thing we should have in the back of our mind. They will not appreciate it. But the reason we have to do it is because we have been commanded by God to show love. And once we have been commanded by God to show love, we should not be looking or thinking or what the person that we are dealing for will do, what will be the reaction, what will they do in return, or what will they say in return. We should not be able to be thinking about that. Because if you think about that, or you will be discouraged to even help the rare person that really need help, you will be discouraged. Maybe the first person that came, they didn't really need the help. But the second person on the way coming is the person that really need that help. But for what that first person have done now, you discouraged to help the second person that is coming to you for help. So we should always put in the back of our mind not to be particular or what the person will do or say after we have rendered help or show their love in Jesus' name. Because when Jesus met the 10 leper, he healed all of them. But we found out only one person came back to Jesus. Jesus said, were they not nine? Where are the rest? So the rest, they didn't have gratitude. They didn't see it as a big thing that God has done for them. So they went.
Okay, hold on. Hold on. Don't go too far. Now, what does that tell us?
It tells us that pastors, people will always be there with ungratefulness.
Very good.
Yes.
There's another thing that thing tells us too. It tells us that people will be ungrateful.
Yeah.
You know that. But it also tells
us. And it also tells us that that's why God, he knew that they were going to be ungrateful, but he also healed all of them. Because he knew that all of them were not coming back.
He also tells us another thing.
That we expect. If Jesus Christ
has God, we'll ask that question.
Yeah.
How much more?
Then how much more
will
we
ask
him? What did we expect?
Yeah.
If it doesn't happen the way we expect or to our expectation, what do?
We leave it. We just let it go.
Don't ask about that. We let it go. But there's something we always want to see. There's also what we say. Even Jesus as God expected that.
Yeah.
Come back.
Yeah.
But it's only, it was only one that came.
Oil one.
And this is even has to ask. Mm-hmm. Where are the rest? It's only you. What happened to the rest?
Yeah.
It means that Jesus as God also expects appreciation.
Yeah.
In fact, God expects us to appreciate him.
Yeah, that's right.
One of the greatest things we will do for God is to appreciate God for what he has done for us. And God expects it. Not just because we need to appreciate. He expects us. That's why we worship God. God expects you to worship him. God expects you to praise him as God. But man, I'm not saying that you should go and praise man and start worshiping man. No. That's not the topic. That's not the question I asked. I realized this, that in fact the Bible says when you appreciate what God has done for you, you begin to do more. But you see, the issue that we have to understand is that it's actually about the person that received his help. Because believe me, what happens is that in the future, you might not receive help again.
That's what we are saying.
Mm-hmm. Not even from that person, and even from other people. Yeah. Because you don't deny yourself opportunity.
You need gratitude.
Let us understand something. The Bible talks about in this last days, people will be ungrateful. Now, the last days mostly refers to when Jesus Christ left the scene. So from that time to these days, people are going to be ungrateful. So we have, as believers, we must hold a habit at the back of our mind that no matter what we do, people will be ungrateful.
Yeah.
And it's not everybody who is going to be ungrateful, but people, a majority, will be ungrateful. Let's hold on to the letter that are going to be grateful and then give glory to God, because you are not. First thing, I'm not doing it because of me. I'm doing it because of God. Yeah, because it's a command upon my life to do it. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And if we look at it from the perspective of the Bible, we will not be worried at all as believers.
Yeah.
Because God knows that even Christians in the house of God, no matter what you do, you have, I posted something on WhatsApp and actually I said, no matter what you do, whether you do good or you do bad, you have people talking about you.
Mm-hmm.
So do you go, Papa, say, I'm not
what is right.
That's right. So do
what is right.
Know what pleases man, but what pleases God. Oh. Because you can never in your life please man.
Of St. John, 1 John that you read.
Yes.
I think it's verse 19 through 20. But my question, I don't understand it. I want you to give me some meaning.
Chapter
3.
No, verse 19.
Yeah, chapter
The second part of it is 19 and 20 is together in my Bible. It said, when our hearts make us feel guilty,
that's
we can still have peace with God. God is greater than our hearts, and He knows everything. Could you, in relation to what you were saying, what does that mean?
Can we read from Arab version?
It's okay, let me read. It said, for if our heart condemns us, God is greater than our hearts and knoweth all things. God knows why our heart is condemning us.
In relation to the verses before that.
Yeah, in
that's
relation.
What I said, that's what I said.
Yeah, verse 19 says, okay, so verse 19 says, and hereby we know that we are of the truth, and shall assure our hearts before Him.
If you read 17, 18, 19, then that's when you understand what I'm asking about.
But whoever has this word looks and see his brother in need and shut up his heart from him, how does the law of God abide in him?
Now let's
get to 20.
Minister, let's read 21, because is it beloved, if our heart condemns us not, then have we confidence towards God? So if our heart is condemning us, God knowing, then we don't have confidence towards God.
I'm talking in relation to loving our neighbor and doing the kinds in action, as it's been explained here.
Hey, now look at it this way. If, let's talk in relation to helping. Mm-hmm. You see somebody, you have ability to help. But you are not led in your heart that this is the right thing to do. Your heart does not condemn you. Do you see? Do you still think there's need to help that person?
No.
Okay.
No. That's basically what the Bible says.
But sometimes you see somebody and you know that you're in a position to help right away, and then you walk away. And when you walk away, you start judging yourself, I should help that person. Then you begin to condemn yourself in your heart. Oh, I should help that person because he didn't do it. Then that's what the power is talking about. Your heart begins to condemn you.
That is true.
But you say, well, God has known everything. He knew that maybe you had the ability to help and he didn't help.
That's right. And you see, that you have the Holy Spirit inside of us. You have the Holy Spirit. Now the Holy Spirit prompts, let's talk as believers. The Holy Spirit prompts you to help somebody.
Yeah.
You know you are in the position to help. You turn back and you started going. You might even not reach far.
Yeah.
And you begin to
pray. Yeah.
This is the
issue.
You see, at some point you want to go back and do what, yes, but if you go, that means your conscience is condemning you. Your heart is condemning you because you have the Spirit of God inside of you, which was who was prompting you to do that, but you refused.
Amen.
Amen.
Our time is up. My sister,